Good evening, everybody. My name is Arvin Schnell. I want to present some things about Butterf, LVM, and Snapper. So, like you have already heard about ButterFS, Butterf is a relatively new file system. I mean, it's a few years old, but still for a file system that's rather young. It has some outstanding features that so far have not been available in Linux. It is entirely based on copy-on-write. That is, whenever something gets written to the file system, nothing is overwritten. It's just a new copy of the new data is written to disk, and then the metadata is also written again, just pointing to the new data block. And this makes journaling almost, it includes journaling this way. It has resilience features. It does checksumming of data and metadata. And this is very interesting in combination with multiple device support. ButterFS itself is not only a file system, but it includes already a volume management system like LVM. It can do RAID 0, 1, 5, 6, and 10. And the RAID type can even be different for the metadata and your data. So, for example, if you have lots of videos, you might risk that some video is destroyed, but not that all of your content is destroyed. Then you could put your metadata on a RAID 5, but the data itself on a RAID 0 or something like that. And another part together with checksumming is scrubbing, that whenever it reads a data block from disk, it checks the checksum. And if there's a mistake and another copy is available on disk, it loads the other block and sees if that's correct. And then writes the broken is rewritten. And this is called scrubbing. It's done automatically during reading, but you can also do this in a batch job to check if you have two hard disks that everything is okay, for example. Not all of these features are considered to be completely stable. For example, RAID 6 is extraordinary new, so it's not considered stable yet. Additionally, ButterFS can do compression, which is transparent for the user, and it does data, or it can do data deduplication. So this is now called offline data deduplication, but you don't have to take the file system offline. It's just that it's not done while writing normally data. So you have to start this manually, and then it looks for data blocks with the same content, and when if it finds one, it just keeps one copy of it, and then two references are pointing to that data block. And so, for example, if you install OpenSUSE, you could run the duplication and it would find like 100 or 1,000 duplicates of the GPL on your disk, and then you save a few megabytes. But for other disks or other use cases, it might be far better. The next feature, this is very important, is subvolumes and efficient snapshots. With snapshots, you can create a snapshot of your entire file system, and it's very efficient. It's done in a microsecond or something like that. It just increases the reference counting of the metadata, and then it's done. And these snapshots can be read-write or read-only. Okay. So then the logical volume manager, which has been around for at least 15 years. With the logical volume manager, you can combine several block devices into a new block device. So if you have like 5 disks, you can create a few partitions on each disk and then combine all of these to one big block device, which is then a few terabyte in size or whatever you have. And these block devices, they can be added, resized, removed at runtime. the volume manager also supports striping, mirroring, and RAID 4 to 6. And the new thing in kernel 3.2 is thin provisioning. Up to thin provisioning, you always, when you created a block device with the logical volume manager, which is called a logical volume, you had to allocate space for it, like 100 gigabyte, and then that space was used. You couldn't use it for other things. Now it's with, you first create a storage pool where you put all your devices in, and then from this you create thin logical volumes. Those are delayed allocation. The storage space from the pool is first is only used when you actually write to the new logical volume. And it even allows overcommit. So for example, you can have on a 1 terabyte disk, you can create a pool and then logical volumes with 10 times the size. This works, of course, until you actually write to it, and then you can add new disks, but you don't have to resize anything or so. And thin provisioning allows also efficient snapshots, where you snapshot your one block device. And here also snapshots can be read-write or read-only. Here's a small picture. So you have your physical volumes at the top, create a volume group. And in the old days, you had logical volumes, those green. And on the right, you see thin provisioning, where you first create a pool and then your logical volumes. So now Snapper is a tool to manage your file system snapshots. It supports ButterFS and LVM thin provisioning. And snapshots can, of course, be created. They are also created automatically every hour. You can configure this. And when Snapper, Zipper, or Yast are called on OpenSUSE, a snapshot is created before and after the Yast or Zipper command. So you can then compare those two snapshots and see what actually has been done by the tool. It also does automatic cleanup of old snapshots. There are two algorithms mainly. One is the timeline, where it keeps more recent snapshots and a few older ones. And the other one is number-based, where it just keeps like 50 snapshots. And we have a command line tool and also Yast GUI. Snapper is, of course, open source. It was developed at SUSE and is still developed. We started about 3 years ago. By now, Fedora has also packaged it, and also some other distributions. With Snapper, you can work with several subvolumes. So, for example, you can have a configuration for your root file system and for your home directory. Something like that is possible. And for every metadata, for every snapshot, Snapper keeps track of several metadata things, which the file system snapshots don't do. So you can have a description, the cleanup algorithm, the user who created the snapshot, and some user data, which is just a pair of key value pairs. So then you can see, like, I installed mPlayer here. Then you know in a few months what you did there. So the nice thing is that it compares those snapshots and displays the difference to you. For that, we distinguish three snapshot types. It's called single, pre, and post snapshot. Single snapshot is like the hour ones, which has no correlation to other snapshots, and pre and post always come as two. So pre is the pre snapshot is created before Yast runs, and the post snapshot after it. And then last not least, it can revert files. So when you've done some change with Yast, and you don't like it, you can just say undo change, give the snapshot numbers, and Snapper will revert the files. Snapper is also a DBus interface. For that, Snapper was split into a server and a client part. The server is started automatically by DBus daemon whenever it's needed. And Snapper DDoS operations only allowed by root. This is, for example, in LVM, all the LVM tools only work as root. You have to mount a snapshot in LVM. And even in ButterFS, deleting snapshots, for example, is only allowed for root. And the configuration can be made that, for example, the user can operate on his own files, home directory, so that the root administrator is not bothered by users that want to restore some files. And the DBus interface is also used by libzip and Zamba, for example. Zamba also has support to trigger snapshots on the Zamba server and export them. So now I want a short demo. So first we list what snapshots are currently available. There's one called zero. This is always the actual system. It's a kind of pseudo snapshot. And snapshot one is a timeline created a few days ago. Now we call just remote. And yeah, we just allow allow remote administration of our system. It's not the fastest notebook. So one click. Now we can list the snapshots again. And we see that there are two new snapshots, number two and number three. And the description says just remote, so we know we changed some remote settings here. Now in the background, Snapper is comparing those two snapshots. And we can then see the status. This will now maybe take another few seconds until the comparison is done. But then we will see what files have been changed while Yast was running. It's not actually the files Yast changed, it's just in the timeline. So if several users are doing things at the same time, the results might, of course, be a bit smeared out. Yeah, we have to wait a few more seconds. Yeah, this is unfortunately still a rather slow operation. We have better support in 13.2, sorry. Ah, okay, now it's done. You see four files, like etc sysconfig display manager, and we can go one step further and see the actual changes, the diff of each file. And there you can see that some system setting was changed from no to yes. You can do the same with the yes2 snapper tool, if you like it more fancy with colors. So show the changes, and we have a file tree here, and then we can select the file, and here we see in colors the changes that were done. And then the last step is, if we don't like what Yast has done, we say undo change, give the two numbers. Mistyped. And Snapper has now reverted those four files. What it does not do is restart any service or something like that. So either you have to reboot or know what services to restart. So one new thing that will be available in 13.2 is that we also allow to boot snapshots. Actually, it's already available, or you can already boot a snapshot in 13.1, but with Snapper, we can now then set up the system to boot the next time the changed snapshot. So first you have to, if you have ruined your system, first you have to reboot, then tell grub to boot a certain snapshot. And then after that, you have to use Snapper to tell, to set the default file, the default subvolume that ButterFS mounts if a file system is mounted. And yeah, this system needs a bit special preparation for that. For example, your subvolumes have to be listed in etc/fs tab, otherwise they don't show up after mounting a different file system. Yeah, I'm running out of time, I see.
I'm invoking me, I get to kick you out.
Yeah, I know. So this is a 13.1, but with new Snapper tools. And I started in graphical mode just to that we can see better what's going on. So first we create a good snapshot. So snapper create. We have to remember the number now, but it's number one. And then we ruin our system. I remove bin bash. That should be enough. So you can actually, if I would now start a machine, it actually boots with a few errors, but I cannot log in. So what I do now is in the grub boot menu, I have to set the root flags for the, or the boot, nee, the mount flags for the root file system, that is root flags subvolume. Now the path of the snapshot, which you have to know more or less. And at least now the system should boot. Unfortunately, it will be read-only because Snapper creates read-only snapshots. And you will see there are a few error messages now due to that read-only file system. But at least I can log in. I have a shell. You will see if I touch some file, it says read-only file system. And now all I do have to do is say snapper rollback, it creates two new snapshots. One is read-writable, and that one is now instructed to be booted when you restart the system. And so you have to reboot again. So now the system will boot and you have a working system again. I can already take questions if there are any. Apparently not. Then robot. Yeah, I just want to show that the system is now read-write again. So now I can touch a file and it's working again. So I've recovered from a rather stupid mistake. And yeah, that will be new in 13.2. So thanks.